So today's talk, and Colin has the slides, and I'm unfortunately unable to get on the internet, so I'm just going to ask Colin to move slides along during my part. The discussion today is about a toolkit Colin Talbert that USGS Fort Collins Science Center developed in collaboration with Jeff Morissette and some other people to basically get phenology data, some satellite phenology data, out to users, ArcMap users, make sure it's that they have opportunities to do summarizations, do subsetting, and do analysis of these data. And so it was a fairly challenging task. There's quite a bit of data behind this. And if you could go to the background slide, Colin. Basically, Colin and the group at Fort Collins Science Center decided that that this particular process would work best inside of the LCMAP framework. The project itself was a science support partnership program project that was sponsored, that program provided some early sponsorship for Great Northern LCC data management efforts. And while most of the work on SSP was about developing LCMAP and working with data management, Colin took the lead on developing an implementation of how LCMAP could be used to serve ArcMap users. And so this is what we'll term a reference implementation for using very large data sets and image services from LCMAP on your desktop. Go to the next slide. The slide here should be a little graphic. And just a quick background on LCMAP. It was initially sponsored by the Great Northern LCC. It's been expanded to support a variety of other LCCs. And it allows partners from a lot of different organizations to collaborate on data, to build data sets, to share data resources, to discover data resources across LCCs and across other projects. There's a lot of components to LCMAP. There's from data discovery, metadata development, analysis. The parts in the red box, the red circles, are the parts we're going to discuss today, and that's data and model development and capture through capture in LCMAP, and then getting those data out to data analysis, out to data users, not through a website, but through a client, a desktop application. Next slide. So LCMAP, which is built on the USGS, or Department of Interior, science-based tool, not an end-to-end solution. It doesn't have tools for every challenge. Instead, it's basically a repository as a service. It allows you to capture data and get data out to different clients, different users who basically design tools that are good for their projects and their mission. Data can be added to and delivered from LCMAP as web services. So there's a lot of different ways to move data around, both in and out of the system. In this specific example, large imagery data sets can be delivered as an image service. And this lets a subset of users build some pretty robust tools that interact with the repository services. Next slide, Colin. Accessing LCMAP, basically, there's a concept of a community. A community controls a space, and they collect a lot of different things there, from metadata to data sets to tools, to documentation, and the data sets in the community, everything in the community space can be secured to one person, a group of people, related projects, or open to the public. In the case of this particular effort, there was a time when the project had to be constrained to just a subset of users, but then later on, Collins developed this so it can be expanded and exposed to a much broader set of users as well as the public. As I said, a space can be comprised of data, all the different components you need to build a toolkit. And then the analysts basically access this space and use it to deliver their analyses to a broader audience. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Colin Talbert. Colin has been the lead on this project and has basically discovered brand new ways to interact with LCMAP, and he's going to talk
introduction to phenology, just in case anyone isn't familiar with the concept or the data that we're trying to deliver. So at its root, phenology is just some measure of when biological or ecological processes kick off. So the timing of these events, and that the classic one are, you know, when do the birds arrive from their annual migration, you know, is a climate change starting to influence that and drive those events earlier or later, or when do the lilac blooms emerge? You know, these are classic examples. And traditionally what's been done is field biologists will go out into the field and they'll, you know, take measurements at a time interval to say, you know, in the sequence of years, this is how that event has changed. And of course, that's driven by weather and climate and various factors like that. The one that we're focused on with this data is the state of the greenness, or the NDVI, the green up of the vegetation across the landscape. And to get at that, so to move it out of a site-specific or a field site location and into more of a landscape blanket data set that managers or analysts can use, we move the concept of phenology up to a satellite sensor-driven data set. So the sensor that's commonly used for phenology is the MODIS, which stands for Moderate Resolution Imaging Spectroradiometer, or satellite, which was launched in 2000 by NASA. We've got a satellite that's circling the Earth, taking 250-meter resolution imagery every day or two. And this imagery is multiband, and there's a series of a couple different algorithms they use to calculate how green the vegetation is. I'm sure most of you are probably familiar with NDVI, EVI, slightly less well known, but capturing basically the same concept, perhaps more robustly to certain environmental conditions. So basically, we have a wall-to-wall coverage of the greenness at 1 or 2 day intervals. And you know, so the initial thought from, say, a scientist or a manager is, hey, that is fantastic data. I want to apply that to my management question or my research interest. But the problem with that lies in that there is so much data. So if you're talking, you know, time steps every day or two, and you've got 180 grids per year, it's noisy data, some of the data is cloud cover, you know, there's so much pre-processing that it becomes very difficult to do anything with that raw data. So what they do is condense it into a phenology metric, which is what this slide is. So what they've done, this would be an example of a single pixel across time. So how green it is, you know, in the spring, it's very brown over the winter. And then at some point in the spring, all of the greenness comes back to the landscape, all the vegetation comes back from dormancy, and that spectral response the satellite is measuring ramps up to a peak across the growing season, and then it comes back down. So you have these specific events that our data set delivers on a yearly time step instead of the hundreds of daily time steps. And then the two that are probably easiest to comprehend are the date of green up, which is one on this chart, and the date of brown down, which is two. But all of the other metrics give us valuable information about what's going on the landscape. And if you kind of imagine this concept applied across the entire grid, then you can have things where we can take that information and start to analyze specific management or research questions. So things like if the green up is coming earlier and, you know, it's followed by an early brown down, perhaps there's an increased risk of wildfire, or, you know, the effects of drought can be measured in that it doesn't green up quite as much. So all of our values are peaking lower and maybe that's going to have some known effect on wildlife. You know, you might also have before after things. So a fire came through. How did that affect cleanup? Well, it greened up a lot earlier and a lot more intensely than the spring after our burn or after our grazing. You might have multiple management units. You could say, all right, in management unit A, we have no grazing. In management unit B, we do. How is that manifest in terms of a phenological response? Those are the types of questions that are often answered with phenology data. At the fort, what we mainly use it for, and in the modeling group that I'm a part of, is species distribution modeling. So a lot of times we want to know where invasives are going to spread. Well, a limiting factor in their spread might be the length of growing season. Right? They're not going to be able to produce flowers if the growing season is less than 60 days. So you can kind of make predictive maps of areas that you might want to treat for. So those are some of the use cases for MODIS phenology data. And so that's what phenology is. Those are some of the things you might want to use it for. But now we kind of get to the problem. So we've already taken immense wealth of MODIS data and condensed it down 100-fold to get these phenology layers. But how, you know, we didn't create these phenology layers. A group led by Ben Tan out of the NASA Goddard Center created them and is freely distributing them. So that's great. You'd think that, okay, you know, these data are freely available. Scientists, managers would be able to just grab them and go. But what we are finding is that's not exactly the case because of how the data are delivered. They're delivered in the context or in the format that's familiar with the group of remote sensing scientists and, you know, basically rocket scientists that use these data and produce these data on a day-to-day basis. But it turns out for someone using them in ArcMap, there's quite a bit of overhead to get them prepped and projected and whatnot before you can use them in ArcMap. And starting with the fact that they're coming as individual HDF tiles that have one band for each of those metrics that I mentioned. So you have to kind of go into some kind of obtuse naming convention, figure out which tiles you need, go out to an FTP site, download them, unzip them, figure out which bands you need. Well, then it turns out, oh, you know, depending on what software you're trying to get them with, you might need to download some additional software to extract them from HDF, get them out of that, and you've got to define, you know, it's a process that I've gone through as a GIS analyst, and I think, you know, we were spending 100 hours or 80 hours or 40 hours to kind of go through all of this and kind of get this ready, this data ready to do any sort of meaningful analysis. But, you know, we kind of came to the conclusion it doesn't need to be like that. You know, we only, and so we kind of came up with a solution to kind of get around that problem of a lot of data, format that's maybe not designed to go directly into the tools we're using, and, you know, bandwidth constraints and all of those problems that I'm sure everyone's familiar with. And this is the solution we came up with. We were going to use a single GIS analyst program or a team of folks here to do all of the heavy lifting and just cache the results. So we're going to download every single tile. We're going to do all the extraction, all the reprojection. You know, we'll have quality control. We'll get a nice product. You know, the value we've added is we've taken all of this data in an HDF format and converted into a format that any a single geotip layer for each metric that you can just bring right into ArcMap. You still have the problem that, okay, so we've created these really easy-to-use layers, but then how do you get them to someone at a field station or get them to someone at a university? Well, you can't, you know, they could send me a hard drive and I could put all 500 gigs on there, or they could send me a request and I could maybe like zip out a little chunk and send it to them. But even that's difficult because each of these layers is at a yearly time step and they'd have multiple files and all of that. And we found that if we were to serve these up as an ESRI image service, a lot of the functionality, in fact, most of the functionality of having those data locally in ArcMap would still be available to end users, even though the data was being streamed from a service. So from the end user's perspective, we could make it look like you have all 500 gigs of this and you don't have to worry about grabbing the right tile or downloading or versions or all of that. We can kind of maintain quality control in that product and support users from afar. And I don't know how much experience people have with ESRI Image Services. They're pretty easy to use, but a lot of stuff still requires a fair amount of work. You have to know about Image Services. You've got to establish a connection to the server. When you bring them into ArcMap, they don't come with any kind of meaningful symbology or no data value set, so they're kind of hard to view. And, you know, so there's problems with that, and we wanted to kind of make it as easy for an end user as possible. And so we decided to create a toolbox to kind of wrap, you know, the next layer, you know, kind of get rid of the last bit of difficulty with delivering these data to end users. And the functionality we decided to focus on was, one, just bringing the data into ArcMap. You know, it should be very simple. Select, I want such and such a year, such and such a metric, and I just want to see what they look like and how they overlay my area of interest. So, you know, we added that functionality. We realized that not every application is set up to handle data being delivered in an ESRI image service. So we also wanted to provide users with easy functionality to just get a local folder of these data for their area of interest. So I'm going to be running a MacSense analysis. It's looking for a folder full of ASCII's. I can run this tool, generate those outputs, and then, you know, point my other tool or my R analysis or my ERDOS at that folder of local files, and then it kind of makes it much easier to kind of use those across the board, even with the limitation of, okay, so I'm not going to be consuming them directly in ArcMap. And then the other thing we wanted to provide users was the ability to do summary statistics, to get a picture of, okay, so here are my management units. What do these data look under, you know, look like, you know, what are they saying about my management units or my question of interest, without having to know all of the particulars about, you know, GIS extraction of pixel values and summarization and then creating a good-looking chart from that. You know, once again, we have our statistician kind of hand that analysis and just deliver it within our toolbox. And I'll give an example of that in a second. And then the last thing we wanted to do was provide a user-friendly documentation of this data set. So a lot of people either aren't familiar with phenology or aren't familiar with our the version of phenology MODIS data that we're using. You know, our toolbox provides links to the academic journals that describe the methodology used to create it, simple breakdowns of what each metric is displaying, things along those lines. So, and I think the solution that we came up with is pretty pretty good example of how these common problems can be addressed in a seamless, for the ARC user, method. So I'm doing my analysis, I'm in ArcMap, boom, I can consume these data without going to a website and drawing a box and downloading something to my temp drive that gets zapped a week later. You know, those types of issues. So with that, I'm going to switch gears to an actual live demo of this tool. So I've got ArcMap open here for those of you familiar with that. You know, it's basically used to do any sort of GIS analysis. And what I'm going to do is, you know, kind of walk us through a case study of what this might look like for the end user network built to cooperate. Let me, the demo area that I always use is Theodore Roosevelt National Park, and go in to add in their a little shape file of their area of interest. The park's divided into two, a north and south polygon, and I display that like this. Now, so let's say I'm a manager at this park or an analysis, and I hear about phenology, and I heard a talk at ESA, and someone was saying, we need this. So I opened up my tool that I downloaded from LC Map, and it gives you a little rundown of, you know, the background of the tool. There's a link in here. If you do a shift click on this, it'll take us right to the academic paper where the timesat algorithm used to describe it, exactly what it's doing, what each of the metrics are, so you can kind of get a background on what MODIS phenology is. And then, you know, as you click on each one of these, it kind of will describe to you what the vegetation indexes are. There's another link to get more information about those. The metrics that I described in my one slide, there's documentation on, okay, what is season length? Well, that's the time from the start of the season to the end of the season. So now we can kind of find areas where the season length is less than a certain amount. And then there's also the ability to choose what temporal coverage we want. Are we interested in a specific year? Like, we treated it in 2003. Let's get 2003 and 2004 and see, you know, how phenology changed over those times. In this case, I'll go ahead and grab all. I won't get into season, but there is documentation on that as well. Click OK. Oh, it's running over here. I didn't get it over in time. And so what it's doing, it's not accessing any data on the local system. What it's doing is sending a service call down to Denver and bringing in the pre-symbolized data for green up for all years. So the areas that are the lighter blue had a spring green up that was later in the season. Not a lot of variability because we're kind of zoomed into a close area. The darker blue greened up earlier, lighter blue greened up later. But be aware that this is a image service data, and it's also time aware. So you can open up the time slider, since I selected all years when I added this, and now we can do things like slide back and forth, and there's a little bit of a lag, but very manageable, and you can see that, you know, in 2002, things greened up quite a bit later, and you can kind of see some of the temporal variability over time. So it's kind of a nice way to bring it in and kind of compare metrics, see what's happening. Everything comes in pre-symbolized with a meaningful color ramp and labels. And the metadata is delivered from within the toolbox. We don't have an interface for that, but it's available in the doc folder of the toolbox. So that's use one. We just want to see this data. We want to start to explore it. Now, the really nice thing about how ESRI has set up these image services is if I want to do something like, let's say I want to do a con statement and get all of the days that are less than 90, all of the green up days that are less than 90, I can use this layer as if it was local. So I can go into a spatial analyst toolbox and say, all right, I'm going to do a con statement. If that'll open. Yeah, and I can just drag this right in as if it was a local layer, and it will honor that, and we've done it well. And, of course, you have to realize that this is coming across your bandwidth. So, you know, if you want to, say, take all of the data for North America and, you know, do a moving window on that, it'll try to do it, and it'll succeed, but it'll take quite a long time. And so I think if that's your use case where I'm doing kind of heavy lifting, where I'm kind of analyzing all of the data set, you know, it would make more sense to contact us and just get the raw data on a hard drive. If you're just looking at a local park, a county, even up to a state area, you know, you can pipe the data dynamically as you need to. We've been very impressed with how well ESRI handles that seamlessly within their application, even though it's 500 gigs of data in total. You know, it's only dealing with megabytes. It only pulls down the data that it needs to do what it needs to do. The other option that we did is we need these data locally for some external process or for some scripted solution or something along those lines. We've got a little interface here where you can say, all right, these are the data I want. I want to, you know, grab all years. I want to grab all metrics, select metrics. You can do a little intermediary processing with the season. You can kind of set the extent, some of that stuff. And then what you do is point it to a empty folder, and it'll just download all of those in there. I'm not going to run it now because it takes a minute or two for each layer, but I run this right before the demo. We can take a look at that real quick. Bear with me while I navigate to where I downloaded that. Workspace. So this local file, so I had put this into the output directory, clicked go, and then it populates this entire folder with all of the things that I set. Nice naming conventions, you know what it is. You know, it's NDVI Brown Downs for 2006. And now I can write scripts against that. I can read these in R. I can do anything I might need to do with local copy, even though they originated from the server in Denver. So that's option number two, just kind of easy way to deal with that. And then the third option is we want to do a simple analysis of this. So let's say my park's got a north area and it's got a south area. Well, how do those differ in phenological response? I can drag in my polygon of areas. You have to point to the field that differentiates those two polygons from each other. Point to an output folder and navigate to that precached one. And on this, I kind of tweaked my code really quick for the purposes of this demo so that it would go would produce the output relatively quickly. In practice, each layer that you analyze takes a minute or two. It's not bad, but in cumulative, running the analysis I'm about to do, takes between 5 and 20 minutes, you know, maybe up to a couple hours if you're really pushing the extent boundaries. But I set it so that it'll cycle through it really quickly. And then if you have R installed on your program, when this tool loads up, it'll go find in your registry where R is installed so that it can run the analysis of the data extract. Now, if you don't use R, don't have R installed, it'll still run, but instead of getting the nice PDF graphical output of what it's about to extract, it will only give you a CSV that you could, say, bring into Excel, and I'm going to make some charts from that, or whatever charting application you happen to be using. So I'll go ahead and select OK. Now it's cycling through, and since I've already cached the result, it's going much quicker than it would. But if you could imagine a minute between each of those lines being written, and that would be about the experience a user would see. And it'll cycle through. And what it's doing is cycling through all of the layers in the image service, extracting out the values from underneath my polygons, storing them in a CSV, and it's sent to the R application with this command line. R, as everyone probably knows, is very good at producing these kind of graphs. This just popped up to the right off on my other screen, and what it is the PDF document that R produced with the summary of the phenological metrics extracted from our parks. So we have things like the beginning of the green-up season, the end of the green-up season, for each of the years for which we have data. You can kind of look for trends across that, and then this is a multi-page document. So I mentioned we have a north and south site. You can kind of look for differences between north and south, kind of see some of the color variation, which represents the large integral, so basically the volume of greenness under that curve. And see some of the variation in that, or some of the variation in thickness. And then also representations of the growing season curves, where each of these lines is the curve for a single year, and the thicker black line is the average across all years. And you can start to tell a story from this, where in the north, where there is, and I forget which, but there's grazing on one of these polygons and not on the other. And, you know, perhaps that's leading to a phenological response where the NDVI is lower on the south site versus the north site. And that's all being extracted from our data, and we can start to look at some management implications of phenology. And a few other graphs of that, like trends over time and variability across our sites. So that's the idea on the pool output. And I'd like to stress that this is, you know, paralleling our workflow and our data, but the underlying concept and framework of data being delivered by an image service, writing a toolbox that does some sort of R analysis, I think has broad implications for a number of different analytical techniques where you're kind of leveraging spatial data and statistical analysis in R and delivering that to users in a way that they don't need to be a GIS expert or a statistician to get the graphs that they need to answer a science question. I think we're in discussion about spinning up Prism BioClim toolbox that will deliver another data set along these same lines to users. I'd like to see this type of user-friendly interface kind of leveraged more in these tools. So that's the end of the demo. If anyone has any questions, I would welcome those, or perhaps maybe we should hold the questions for the end and have Tim Kern finish up with a couple more overview slides.
Thanks, Colin. And following up on Colin's comment, if you could go to the slideshow again. So what this plays into, as Colin pointed out, this is complicated stuff. This is analyst-level work, 1,700 specialized formatted files are boiled down to 40-something geotips, which then get boiled down into a way to summarize the data, a way to subset the data, a way to do separate different types of analysis of the data. It's extremely important for GIS analysts, especially working at landscape conservation, with habitat conservation and landscape integration projects, to do these types of analysis. It's not for everybody, as Colin pointed out. This is rocket science, and it is trying to boil things down to a level that an ecologist, a resource manager, can actually use. There's a lot of work on this. So there's a project going on right now. Sean Finn, myself, Jim Strickle from Database, and Natalie Lapiche from the USGS are working on an effort to build an integrated data management network for the LCC. And part of this project is a tool shed. It's an analytic and spatial tool development space. And Brendan Ward from Conservation Biology Institute, working for Jim Stritholz at Data Basin, is taking the lead on developing protocols, ways for people to do the types of things Colin has done and some other people have done, using LCMAP and other repositories and Data Basin to get specialized tools out to communities of sort of communities of users for their special needs, rather than build portals that forces everybody into the same model that Colin works with. We let Colin and his group develop their own specialized tools using data that's in this repository. So the tool integration activities, working with specific data sets, and developing the arena for this collaborative work is what's going on right now with the IDMN project. We do want to make sure to stress that we're trying to focus on open source programming. Colin's code is available and it can be reviewed and implemented and altered by anybody else who wants to develop other workbench and tool shed activity. If you go to the next slide, Colin. So the IDMN project is the going on right now, and if people want to get involved in this tool shed, they can contact us. And this includes any LCC cooperator, anybody working with the climate science centers right now. Jeff Morissette, the director of the North Central Climate Science Center, is also leading an effort to look data challenge. And this is the type of thing that Colin's efforts, people can build on efforts like Colin has done and others have done, to use data that the USGS and other agencies like the Fish and Wildlife Service have are making available to people through these repository service projects, and to try to get data out to different collaborative groups. And this includes citizen scientists, scientific professionals, and it includes not just Colin's focus has been on some ARC map projects. There's another project going on which is trying to get data out to mobile users, mobile devices. If people want to get involved with this, there's a URL at the bottom of this slide, Amplifying USGS Data. It's at challenge.gov. And again, this is something that if you start building toolkits like this, these would be perfect examples of taking this to the next level and helping the broader community analyze data that's held in these fairly robust repositories. And with that, I'll turn it back over to the moderator. Any questions?
Great. Oh, thank you so much. And we do have a question, actually. The question is from Natalia, and she would like to know, where do you get the toolbox?
Okay. So we're serving it up through ScienceBase, and I'm remiss for not including the URL to it. Pull that up real quick.
We'll call it non-obvious URL to get to the toolkit. What we can do is
we have a redirect, so it's actually...
You have a redirect, so you're set up on that already. Okay.
Yeah. So it's sciencebase.gov catalog, image server, and that'll redirect you to the space, and then at that space, we've got the draft version of the tool. We're kind of in the final stages of publication and polling. We're answering reviewer comments on that, but the draft version is there. And if you go to that web page, it'll take you here. And we've got a document that kind of describes what I've just demonstrated, as well as the toolbox itself.
Great, thank you. And we do have one more question from Teal. And the question is, are there a set of instructions for use? For example, how to access? I would like to share this information with others. Well, of course, we'll have this webinar recorded and posted on the GNLCC website, so you can always refer back to that.
Uh-huh. And then at this URL, there is a user guide that kind of walks you through the process of adding it to ArcMap and using it. But be aware that is in the final stages of review, and we've got a newer version that'll be up there within the week, let's say, along with a update to the toolbox that addressed a few last-minute bugs. But this URL will get you to that information.
Are the raw VI data available, and what about the lag time?
VI data are not available through this because it is, another two orders of magnitude more data, and it is, kind of beyond the scope of this project to deliver all of the, that amounts to all of MODIS's data holdings. It is not, we could put you in contact with the folks there, but we have not attempted to do that, nor did we ever really do anything with the raw VI data. We got a derived product, and that's all we've worked with. The lag time in terms of working with these data from a remote resource, for a small area or even for a large area, if all you're doing is viewing it, the lag time is very reasonable. Seconds or less to display all of this data for the Western Hemisphere, or under a minute to analyze a section that's up to say a county size. So the lag time, even with it being a remote service-based data delivery, is not bad at all.
And I will throw out there that, as Colin pointed out, the raw data is through the MODIS project, and that reference is available through LC Map. The derived data that Colin's working with is still pretty large. It's still several hundred gigabytes of data. It's not easily downloaded. However, if a project has a need for it, we've set up a specialized tool to help them get it, basically subset and get that in a non-peak time period. So we've got that available. You can contact me directly on that. Those data, again, a lot of the, as Colin has pointed out, there's a lot of work that the U.S. you have to go through in the USGS to make sure that your data products are available to the public. So we'd like to make sure we have some of control while it's going through the review and assessment process.
Great. And Rob Sparks has a question. Is there a variance value associated with the layers values?
Variance value associated with the layers value. There are a couple quality control metrics. One, there's an internal quality flag is one of the convenience metrics we give, and that's from the original MODIS. So you'd have to refer to their documentation how to interpret that. And the variance that we have is across polygons, so the standard deviation of the green updates across our northern Theodore Roosevelt polygon. We provide that, but I don't think there is a variance metric. Take a look back. I do not believe it has a variance, which would be per pixel over time. And let me just verify that from our documentation. I take that back. There is a root mean squared error value and then the quality flag that I just described.
Great. Are there any other questions? Jerry says, awesome stuff. I like the zonal stats function using R. So well done. If there are no other questions, which there don't appear to be, we can wrap this up.